Thank you and welcome back to Race Industry Week 2023.
Yeah.
Our next session, we're going to have Jonathan from Mazda with us. And as we mentioned this morning when we opened the show, if you're watching us on Zoom, on racer.com, on speedsport.com, on our YouTube channels, on Speedsport One, or any social media outlet, please share the links with your friend. Email the links, text the links, whatever you want to do. But, you know, please feel free to invite your friends in the industry. We make this event free of charge for anyone who want to watch, thanks to our sponsors. So thank you for being with us. George Tamayo, welcome back to the program.
Good morning. How are you?
Excellent. Jonathan is right here, so let's dive into it.
All right. Hey, good morning, John.
Hey.
How are you?
Hey, George. How are you? Hello from sunny Sebring.
Sebring, indeed. So, Jonathan, let me give you a quick introduction more formally. So, Jonathan Applegate joins us from Mazda Motorsports. And you are Senior Manager of Motorsports. I think I get your title wrong every time, but I think that's right.
That's right. You got it. Correct.
Good deal. So, you're down in Sebring. I think you're having a good time with some really super cool historic Mazdas.
Yeah, we're here with HSR, Historic Sports Car Racing, sanctioning group. For the 12-hour historic weekend. And this is our second time out this year with our Mazda Heritage Collection program. So we're just really excited to be out here for our really what is our finale for the 2023 season for our historic efforts.
Yep.
But got a lot going on in 2024 with that as well. And this year was just really an awesome kickoff year for that program. There's been a lot of energy around bringing and resurrecting the historic cars back, both in motorsports and inside the organization as a whole. A lot of people have put a lot of time and effort and energy into getting the cars in a place where they're actually publicly ready to be viewed. But there's been a lot of people before this that have put a lot of effort in to get the cars out. And I think, George, you've been around long enough. You've seen our efforts in the historic space with our rotary powered race cars. Had a lot of effort in the 90s, 2000s, and even in the mid 2000s with that. And it's just over the course of time with transitions from departments and groups and COVID hit and a lot of different things have created a riff in the ability to be at as many historic events that we would want to. So, you know, our CMO, Brad Audette, and leadership from the R&D group internally, as well as motorsports, sort of all put our heads together and said, we have a great group that's been around these cars to maintain these cars, to get them race ready for one-off events and very knee-jerk reaction sort of approach. How do we support these cars on a full-time basis that's going to put our best foot forward and leverage these hidden gems almost, yeah, and these massive assets for us to get, yeah, out into the public eye? So we were able to do that.
A little bit about what you have running out there and who's driving.
We've got two cars right now. We're working on full restoration of others, but we have our 1991 RX-7 GTO. Very, very successful car. And then this one right won the 1991 Drivers and Manufacturers Championship for IMSA, mm-hmm, in the GTO class. And we have the 767, 1989 767B, the predecessor to the 787 that won Le Mans. Same livery charge, a renowned, yeah, charge livery that everybody knows and sees and sometimes often gets confused with the Le Mans championship winning car. But those will also be ran by Tom Long and Andrew Carbonell, some of our Mazda racers of the past and present. So Fliss Performance is here with us operating the program, and cars look top notch so far. We've been on track for two sessions yesterday. We'll go two sessions today. Matter of fact, the 767B is out now. So if you hear some screaming in the background, you know what that's all about. Right. I'm tucked away in an office right now, unfortunately. Fortunately to talk to you though. So we're excited just to be out to Sebring and to get these out. We have a plan to look at 2024 and really identify the regions and some other events to get to both on East and West Coast and really spread the love. Cause at the end of the day, this program, great to be on the racetrack with these cars and compete, but it's all about getting in front of our enthusiasts, our owners, and those that have been passionate with the brand for so long and have such a deep passion for these cars. So it's really at its core why we're out here in the first place.
Yeah. Talk a little bit more about that enthusiast connection, because I'm sure it does a lot to just continue to develop that support and that affinity for Mazda Motorsports and remind people that the history that Mazda has in racing is very long and very rich.
Yeah, I've had the pleasure this year of not just with our Mazda Heritage Collection programs, but also have the ability to go to Japanese Classic Car Show and Seven Stock. And when you look at the group that is supporting those events and attending those events, both on the historic race car side and these enthusiast events, it is just amazing to see the outpouring of passion that these fans have and owners have for Mazda as a brand. There's clearly a tremendous amount of loyalty that stems from our rotary powered race car days, our Mazda speed days. We get those questions every time we're out in public is, when's the rotary coming back, right? Or, you know, when's Mazda speed? So it's great to see that connection, but it's also really refreshing to see how these same racers, owners, enthusiasts that have been with us for three, four decades now, still recognize Mazda today as the brand, the never stop challenging brand that it was then. Yep. And seeing us in different ways, coming with new, refreshing opportunities, challenges that we're overcoming, finding the road less traveled to do what we're doing with some of our motorsports programs, but also in our eighth generation new production vehicles. That's something that I think we're really raising eyebrows now with our CX-90, our all new CX-90 CUV platform, and coming soon with some new vehicles here in 2024 that able to bridge that gap between what we're doing now with motorsports, what we're doing now with the brand, and really tying those connections of deep passions from the past to present. And it's been really special to see that.
Yeah, super cool. One thing just to stay on the enthusiast track for a second is a kind of a cool event, and I'm wondering if more is going to happen down the road, but you guys just did a kind of a collaboration with Lime Rock Park about a month ago at something called MiataCon. Tell us a little bit about that, and is there plans to do more?
Yeah, I would say shout out to the Lime Rock Park leadership. They absolutely birthed that idea and that concept, and just recognizing who their fans and demographic is in that area that are attending their events, and clearly a heavy amount of enthusiasts of Mazda Miata racers. So they saw an opportunity with a full category that was open for them to really develop something new. So they saw this as something that they've coined as MiataCon. Yeah. They came to us, the motorsports group, and said, hey, we would love this for Mazda to be on board with this and back this. And at the end of the day, this is your racers and your owners, enthusiasts. Have with it what you will, and let's make this happen. So as an inaugural event this year, we partnered with Lime Rock, did some cool things at the racetrack as far as on-track competition with our A's and B's and C's and ND's, up to having some cup cars there as well. Didn't get on the racetrack competitively with the cup cars, but aside from that, car corrals and just really bringing back the enthusiast energy to the Northeast region. So I was super excited to see that happen. And we're looking forward to talking with them actually here in a couple of weeks, and next week at PRI, we'll kick off a conversation. But talking a little bit about what we can do more and start to continue to find opportunities to make those sort of events a category of one, if you will, for us and the brand, for our
enthusiasts. It looked like the turnout was pretty spectacular. The weather was great, so it was a pretty good deal.
Yeah, I think we got a little lucky with the weather up there, George, with the region late October, and it's 65 degrees and sunny. We'll take that every day. But yeah, it was a pretty successful event.
Yeah, great. Looking ahead, I want to talk a little bit with you about what's coming in 2024, but the reality is that 2024 for you guys really kicked off a couple of weeks ago at Atlanta Motorsports Park with the Mazda Scholarship Shootout. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about that, and then pushing into next year, what we have to look forward to.
I feel like we have been on a continuing journey. There is no such thing as an off season this year for whatever reasons, but it's an exciting thing. And just shows that we've got a lot going on in motorsports and with our brand. But the Shootout is a special program. I think we've done a better job this year with live stream and supporting it and showcasing some of the things that we do. But overall, it's such a program that holds near and dear to our hearts, a golden thread, as we call it, that connects what we do with our racers and grassroots. We do with our ambitious aspirational program of MX5 Cup, and just bridging the gap for young racers to come from grassroots through our programs into a competitive environment like the Shootout, where they win scholarships, and bringing them into MX5 Cup. So at November 15th and 16th, that was our shootout at Carolina Motorsports Park. We've been doing it for 16 years running, providing support and scholarships to these racers. We've, over four seasons ago now, we introduced a secondary element to the shootout where we are now giving out scholarships to our Spec MX-5 racers, young karting kids coming into Spec MX-5, which is a class and a program within our grassroots system, which ultimately feeds young talent into MX-5 Cup. So we introduced that. We had 12 finalists on both the MX-5 Cup side and the SMX side, Spec MX-5 side, that came ready to compete. The nerves were definitely there, but aside from that, they all just put their best foot forward, put 2 days worth of track time, interviews with media, a lot of different interactions with judges and coaches that are on the ground, and really trying to explore their full body of work over the course of a two-day event. To then just really drill down, which is the absolute hardest part. Every time, every year, we talk about this internally with the judges and the Mazda folks, and it's heart-wrenching, but also super awesome and just and beneficial to see when we ultimately get to the scholarship. But getting down to those winners is the absolute hardest part, because the talent every year gets more competitive, better and better. We ended up handing out 6 scholarships in total, 3 for MX-5 Cup. The champion receives $110,000 of a scholarship that gets them for a full season in MX-5 Cup in 2024. And that was Weston Workman. Mm-hmm. Weston Workman has been with us for several years, and I think he is the journeyman of our shootout. He's been there more than anyone, but has moved up every year and improved every year, and earned his rights to become a champion this year with a great performance on the track and off the track. He's an all-around great representative of Mazda as from a brand perspective, and will be immediately competitive in MX-5 Cup. So we're excited to see him. We gave our runner-up scholarship to Nathan Nicholson, a fellow Hoosier of mine. Any of you folks out here there from Indiana?
Sure, there's a lot.
Yeah, good. And gave him the runner-up scholarship. Great kid, fast, has proven very successful in grassroots and through our Spec MX-5 programs. Comes from a great family, got a good head on his shoulders. We're expected to see some great things from him. And he actually has a really good opportunity that I can talk about here with 24 opportunities to leverage his representation in the series with our title sponsor, which I'll talk about here in a couple minutes. But he will not only represent Mazda, but he will represent our title sponsor, who will be brand new in 2024 and really be a brand ambassador for them as well, which will be really a good dynamic to see, being a first year to do that. And then last but certainly not least, we handed out our Female and Women's Initiative scholarship to a very deserving young candidate, up and coming. Her name's Sally Mott. She was very fast, but actually found a great choice to be our Women's Initiative scholarship winner. So we're just seeing a lot from her and a lot of blue skies ahead for Sally Mott as well. So we're looking forward to that. And then we handed out 3 other scholarships on the Spec MX-5 side as well, and looking forward to seeing all those young, ambitious kids move their way through the grassroots ranks and get into MX-5 Cup. So shout out to those folks as well.
For sure. That's awesome. Tell us about this sponsorship announcement that you've got coming.
Yeah. As you said, a lot going on with 23, which feels like it's just that constant, continual connection into 24. I don't know which day it is in months sometimes, but we made some pretty key announcements, still not formal in the sense of contractual, but verbal enough to be confident to share, and really have just had an absolute pleasure of meeting and working with this group. We are announcing a new title sponsor for our 2024 MX-5 Cup season to be Whelan Engineering. And very excited working with Sonny and Christine and the family, the Marsh family, Peter, Michelle, the whole group over at Whelan is a phenomenal group. They understand motorsports more than any group that I've ever met. I feel like they're endemically connected to it. They see all of the strings attached to all of the different genres of sport and how they can activate and really maximize their efforts and be a great partner along the way. So we're excited to see what we can do in 24 with them as a title sponsor, and looking forward to continue to grow that relationship more and more throughout the 24 season. We're also very, very exciting times. And then we're also introducing, it's somewhat already in the family because we've had BFGs running on those for several years, but we will take that presenting partnership and move it to Michelin, who's, you know, BFG parent company, but moving over to a brand new tire. We're going to represent the blue and yellow proudly, and have their logos all over our MX5 Cup assets and series. So looking forward to continuing that relationship with Jason and Casey and Joe and the crew over at Michelin, and looking forward to those two brand new partnerships to our group. It's going to be exciting times. And then working with IMSA, you know, that's we've done some key renewals over the course of the last several months. You know, shout out to everybody involved in that. As you know, that takes a lot of effort, but we were able to renew with IMSA, our sanctioning group with MX5 Cup, for 3 years, which is a quite the commitment for us at Mazda, just to do more than an annual. So looking forward to that, the next 3 years there. We've grown tremendously with that group. John Doonan leading that team with the rest of the supporting cast. Couldn't say enough good things about them. But we're actively working to look at ways just to continue to elevate the series and continue to bring more quality on track and off track to the series from all of our groups and partners in general. So the schedule is really cool. I think that's something that with the renewal was very important for us, is just to have a strength of schedule that signifies that bond between IMSA and Mazda. And that's exactly what that is. We're going to 7 doubleheader weekends, our traditional schedule, but we're going to all IMSA specific sanctioned events that are all on their big weekends. We'll be going to Rolex 24 at Daytona to kick the season off. We'll be going to, following that up with the 12 hours of Sebring in March, which is great. We'll be going to Laguna Seca, WeatherTech Raceway Laguna Seca in May, following that up with Mid-Ohio in June. IMSA's bringing that back with the BPRC, Michelin Pilot, and us in another spec category. And then we will go to across the border, which I'm looking forward to go to Canadian Tire Motorsports Park in July. And then we'll finish the last leg of the season with VIR in August, and then at our championship traditional weekend with Road Atlanta Petit Le Mans. So really strong schedule. Our racers have already shown their positive feedback and really excited about getting out there and competing. So I think all in all, we're really looking forward to a very exciting 2024 and continue to move the needle in the right direction.
Yeah, that sounds great. And obviously that bringing Michelin in as a partner, that solidification with IMSA really does provide Mazda and the MX-5 Cup with that portal, that leaping point for those who do aspire to go on to a professional career. They've got now a really kind of a good defined path. But you and I have talked a little bit about the fact that it's not MX-5 Cup as a training ground for those aspiring drivers, I think, is primarily pointed at sports cars, but not necessarily entirely. Tell us a little bit about how you like there's opportunity within MX-5 Cup to go and do other kinds of professional racing beyond.
Yeah. Well, and I think before I even answer that, I do want to earmark the thought and the strategic direction of us saying that is a point, that's a critical point, but we also see MX5 Cup as a destination spec category that is professional. So those that are there, we see racers competing with us year in and year out. This is their home, and they are top talented race car drivers. They could go LMP2 racing. They could jump into a Michelin Pilot program and compete at the top levels. So we see a very good synergy between those that want to stay with us in the destination spec category and those that are ambitious, as they were when they got here, to continue that ambition to move into something else. To your point, IMSA and Michelin make that very, very apparent and obvious for that path. And that's why we're there. It's IMSA says, hey, here's our different legs to sport of sports car racing, or the genre of sports car racing. Here's the opportunities. Present yourself, win some championships, and the sky is the limit. And I think IMSA and Mazda are growing closer in that fashion. But to your point, beyond that, I think there's some really exciting things on the horizon. Those that know Mazda and follow Mazda Motorsports, you've got to do is tune into YouTube to know some of the things that have been brewing and things that we've been doing in the off season, or even in regular season, off the regular path of MX5 Cup. Went to the Martinsville Oval in October. And, you know, that came from just honestly a direct, authentic relationship with NASCAR leadership and them seeing the attractiveness of MX5 Cup for that genre of sport. Stock car racing and sports car racing has gotten so close in terms of the style of racing, with road course racing coming and more apparent than ever in NASCAR, the young and the pool of athleticism, if you will, coming through your regular dirt and your ovals, your asphalt ovals, into all the way to the professional categories of truck, Xfinity, and Cup. And I think there's some synergies there that allow MX5 Cup to fit ourselves into something of a model there that would, you know, initially looking at how we can really bridge the gap or be the intersection between young racers coming into a space where they know they can compete and they get to choose whether they want to go sports car racing or stock car racing through the NASCAR. And because NASCAR and IMSA, they are cohesive. There's something there between that allows us to really examine that opportunity and see what's in store for the future. Really exciting times. Wish I could give you more as far as substance, as far as examples of where we'll be and when. But I know, as our global president and CEO, Morrison, has always said, when he gets a tough question, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. And I'll stay with that.
100%. I'm glad you touched on the idea of MX5 Cup as being a destination in and of itself. And I wonder if you can just talk a little bit more about that idea, because there does tend to be a tendency to focus sometimes within the motorsports rank because of always climbing this ladder, climbing a ladder going forward. But for a whole host of racers, series like MX5 Cup in particular, are really a great place to live out your passion of racing competitively, racing affordably, and being at marquee places, but not necessarily saying, look, it's either, you know, world champion or nothing, right? Like there Correct. Has to be a place for people to compete. So talk a little bit about those racers who are there for the long term.
Yeah. I mean, you said it very well, George. Honestly, that's sort of where we're at, is we're in that spot that allows those that aren't necessarily looking for global superstardom, but really want to be recognized as truly talented and respected in the sports car space. And that's exactly what MX5 Cup produces. Clearly, we support financially with our scholarships getting into, and we have some of the biggest payouts in the country, if not globally, in spec category. And that's attractive for people, right? They want to be there for that, because that they're able to leverage that. Aside, before getting into that a little, is just in and of itself being the racer. You have such a opportunity just being in the IMSA space now with MX5 Cup, and the respect there is there that maybe once got missed from several years ago. And it's not because the racers weren't there. It's not because the talent was never there. It was just because the series was never positioned properly to be really seen in its truest maximum potential form. Mm-hmm. And because we've positioned ourselves with IMSA several years ago now and continue to see ourselves there for the next 3 years, I think that really does give us a wonderful opportunity to just be in the mix, in the sports car ecosystem, seeing everything as sort of a unified front of a community that really just represents motorsports and has the passion for motorsports. And then those racers can stay with us or choose to do what they will with that scholarship or that funding. But the one thing that's really attractive with MX5 Cup that we've seen many racers now, and even scholarship winners turn champions, turn into an actual effective business model, is the team operation side. And that's something that's really important for sustainability. We talk about that when we're going through our scholarship process, and they're like, how can you be the best professional outside of the race car? It's one thing to be fast, to put up the fast pace on the racetrack, but what are you doing from a partnership perspective? What are you doing to a business model allow you to stay in the space for more than one and done seasons or a couple seasons? And I think a lot of people are really looking at MX5 Cup because of the cost effectiveness and the value of the investment, what it takes to get in and stay in, and leveraging that on the team side to position themselves as still a racer, still competing, whether that's an MX5 Cup or somewhere else, and leveraging the outfit of having their own team and bringing in paying racers that are asking them to support their race cars, bringing coaching, and doing everything they can to set them up for success on a full season basis, that then allows that individual or that group to continue to sustain year over year with a team initiative that then complements their racing strategy. So we've seen that with Jared Thomas Racing. We see that with McAleer McCombie. We've seen that with several other teams that continue to find ways to tap into that opportunity. And that's something that I think is an attractive, definitely an attractive point within MX5 Cup for sure.
Yeah, definitely. We've only got a couple of minutes left, but I wonder, since you're talking about Jared Thomas and the other teams that are participating, tell us a little bit about the 2023 season, just a quick recap, because again, it came down to the wire. A first time repeat champion, and clearly the talent level going all the way down through the field was quite extraordinary.
Yeah, again, another great season. Since we introduced the Global Cup car in 2016, the championship has gone down to the last round, the last race, the last round of the season. This one was a little different than 2022, when it literally came down to the last lap in the last round with Connor Zilich and Jared Thomas, and Jared squeezing that championship out by some stroke of maybe good luck or just tenacity and some other situations on track. But this year was phenomenal in the sense that Jared Thomas is the first racer in MX5 Cup history to win a back-to-back championship. Yeah. So for him to be able to put that consistency up from year one champion to year two, and against the full gamut of talent in the series, upwards of 30 racers that could win on any given weekend, it was tremendous to see. We had Aaron Johnson in second, and Celine Rion, one of our seasoned vets, that finished third for the season, and really couldn't be more proud of the entire group that represents Mazda and the MX5 Cup Series. The talent level is there, and I think we continue to prove that every season with more and more of it. So super excited again for the 24th season to start here in only less than a couple months.
Yeah, for sure. Well, thanks for joining us again, Jonathan. All the best and have fun out there. Not too much fun in Sebring, but we'll look forward to seeing what you guys do in 2024.
Okay. Thanks a lot, George. Appreciate the time.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you. And
registering on ePowerTrade is easy. To start, click on the Join for Free button on the homepage. First, search your company to see if it's already in our database. If you see your company on the list, click on it to select it. Then, choose Claim Company if you are one of the decision makers, an owner, marketing person, or main company contact. Or choose Join Company if you are an employee, and press Continue. If you couldn't find your company in our database, select Register a New Company. On the following page, fill out your name, email, phone number, job title, and choose a secure password. If you chose Register a New Company, you'll need to choose your business type. Select Supplier if you're looking to display products or services and connect with buyers. Choose Racing Business if you're looking to source new parts and connect with suppliers. Choose Race Team if you own or are a member of a professional race team. Then, enter your company name. Please provide a website, Facebook page, or LinkedIn if you have one, and choose to either claim or join the company. You can view and agree to our terms of use here. If you'd like to receive our weekly newsletter, choose Accept. Finally, click Register Now and your registration will be submitted for approval. An email will be sent to your inbox. Please confirm your email address and you will be approved shortly. Welcome to ePowerTrade.